If you've never seen this bit before, I want you to tell me. Stop me if you've seen it. I'm going to piss on you. I tell you this because some of the ringsiders have objected to it. And it's just fair to warn you, that's all. I don't make any great show of it, I just do it and that's all.
He was saying things on a nightclub stage that nobody had ever said on a nightclub stage before. He was violating all of the inviolable taboos.
The afternoon of the famous Carnegie Hall concert, I met him for a cup of coffee, and the sidewalks were covered with snow. We were walking back to his hotel, the Hotel America, and the stores had sort of shoveled out a very narrow path. And we were walking down this narrow path, and a young black delivery boy on a bicycle was coming towards us. And there obviously was not enough room for us. So just as the bike got opposite us, Lenny jumped out of the way. And at the same moment, the kid swerved to avoid hitting him and went right into him and sort of pinned him against the wall. And Lenny looked down and said, "That's why they don't let you people on the buses." And to the kid's credit, he broke up laughing. That's the thing. It was very funny. You know, he was typically quick.
Lenny Bruce was the first modern comedian, and he paid a heavy price for it. He was pilloried, hounded, and driven into professional exile for doing in the late 50s and early 60s what later comics were able to do as a matter of course. Lenny Bruce questioned, challenged, and ultimately transgressed every assumption not only about what comedy was, but also about what it could do, and ultimately what it was for.
He was the first and in a sense only comic who ever worked with a sort of jazz musician's persona. It wasn't just a matter of using the words dig and hip and cool and all that. Your sister could do that, but that wouldn't make her hip or funny. But he used it in an authentic way. It was natural to him, and that was his natural manner of speech on the stage.
When he was first surfaced in Los Angeles, Variety, the Bible of show business, panned him unmercifully with a very revealing and prescient line. They said that Mr. Bruce is only trying to make the band laugh. Now, the band has always made a point of not laughing at the comic. It's a point of pride with them. But Lenny completely tore the band up. And so Variety had unwittingly stumbled upon the revolutionary content of Lenny as a comic. He was talking to a hip audience, a jazz-oriented audience.
When people say to me, "How come you're divorced?" I always make up a lie. I say, "My mother-in-law broke up my marriage." I say, "Well, how'd that happen?" So one day my wife came home early from work, and she found us in bed together. She's an old woman, but firm, and
jazz. Specifically, sharp-dressed post-bop provided Lenny Bruce with a milieu, an aesthetic, and a finely tuned sense of style. He wasn't a buff, an expert, or even a connoisseur, but he liked the clothes, the attitude, and the lifestyle. A huge part of his soul resonated with the music's spirit of free-flowing improvisation.
We opened a place called Duffy's on Cahuenga and Yucca.
Jazz trumpeter Jack Sheldon worked with Lenny in the strip clubs and cabaret joints of mid-50s Los Angeles.
And that was a strip place, and we had beautiful girls when we opened. A five-piece band. We had Joe Maney and me, Philly Joe Jones, Kenny Drew, and Leroy Vinegar. We were a hot band. And Lenny Bruce used to, he said it wasn't a party unless you could get some heroin. So he'd get heroin. Lenny was the only guy with like about five people watching him cut up the heroin. He could steal it in front of everybody while he was doing it. And he used to say, "The microphone is my horn." You know, he'd play the microphone. Everybody liked him. We were all just so wild. And he could get stuff going, you know, with parties and girls and all the strippers and And everybody saw that he was real funny, too, and he was different. He was a complete original himself.
To his preposition, come is a verb. To his preposition, come is a verb. To his preposition, come is a verb, the verb intransitive. To come. To come. I've heard these two words my whole adult life, and as a kid when I thought I was sleeping. To come. To come. It's been like a big drum solo. Did you come? Did you come good? 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 Rest with our teeth, I come better with you, sweetheart, than anyone in the whole goddamn world. Everybody came so good. And he came so good because I love you. Now, if anyone in this room or the world finds those two words decadent, obscene, immoral, amoral, asexual, the words to come really make you feel uncomfortable. If you think I'm rank for saying it to you, the ear of the beholder gets rank from listening to it. You probably can't come.
A visiting San Francisco nightclub owner spotted him in L.A. and lured him to play her North Beach club.
I saw the best minds of my generation destroyed by madness.
Hollywood hipsters and San Francisco beatniks were united by their love of jazz and divided by almost everything else.
Hysterical, naked, dragging themselves through the Negro streets at dawn, looking for an angry fix.
Nevertheless, Lenny added another major card to his comedic hand in little more time than it took to walk across the street from his gig at the Jazz Workshop to City Lights, where he gave himself his crash course in San Francisco's beat philosophy.
God, they said, made your body, but they qualified the creativity. They stopped it above the kneecaps and resumed it just above the Adam's apple.
Lenny would go to the City Lights bookshop between shows.
In 1960, writer Grover Sales was the publicist for many of the jazz clubs in North Beach.
And in between shows, he would look for new material. Furley Getty, the owner of the bookshop, had published a Howl. He published all of the other beat poets, Kerouac and Lou Welch and Philip Whalen and the others. Incidentally and naturally, they were all Lenny Bruce fans, without exception. There was a natural affinity.
Poet and publisher Lawrence Ferlinghetti was a pivotal figure in the beat movement.
There were others in the neighborhood that did the same kind of rap. There was two black poets that hung out in the front room of City Lights at the same time, and they would do that every morning. We had a place up Grand Avenue here. It was called The Place, and it had a weekly blabbermouth night where people like Richard Brautigan would spout off endlessly. So it was in the air here.
Lenny Bruce was not, by upbringing, a poet or intellectual. Quite the reverse, he was showbiz to the bone. His mother, Sally Marr, was herself an entertainer, a dancer-turned-comic who spent much of her time on the road.
I always thought Sally was his inspiration because I stayed with her.
Jazz singer Annie Ross.
In a little wooden house that she had in Hollywood. And she found some letters in a garage. And they were from a mother to her daughter. And they were full of abuse. It was hysterical. Sally read these letters out, and I had tears, and that's where Lenny got his sense of humor.
The mother writes to be. So I told, what's the kid's name? Jibby. Jibby. I told Jibby. He spent the whole summer in bed with her. I said, look, you're going into the service. If she did it with you, what's she going to do with other guys? You're going to marry her and rule the day. Then Uncle Irving had a heart attack in front of the television set. It was unhappy letters, unhappy letters.
One time we were in Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
Pioneering satirist Paul Krasner.
And in the morning we had breakfast, and there was a man who joined us, just somebody who was also staying there, and they were talking about the movie Psycho. And this guy objected to the shower scene, but not to all the violence in it. And that triggered in Lenny this thought of the inconsistency.
Okay, what goes on in Psycho? We have Tony Perkins, a psychotic misogynist, kills a beautiful woman for no purpose, stabs her, we show method, blood down the drain. Now what goes on in the dirty movie? Any communist propaganda? Anyone getting slapped? Any violence? What are they doing, man? That's that offensive. From artistic concept, you're trite, no music track, forget it. But opposed to a killing, a blatant deterrent to life, what are they doing? So the values are for children to look at, killing, yes, but stupping, no, man. But if they ever see any stupping, they may do that someday, man, and what'll happen then?
I don't think he was being outrageous just for outrageousness' sake. He really had ideas.
Comedian Steve Allen.
Most comedians have no ideas, and most of them don't need it. If a man falls in a pie and lands on the ground in a funny way, we should be grateful for that. But in the case of Lenny, his routines were a matter of saying something. I think really he was a social philosopher who used the stand-up comedy form as his method or his canvas, so to speak. And he wasn't afraid to take on targets that were considered off-limits by apparently all other comedians of his time, and even the great majority of them at the present time, which is supposed to be so daring.
Dick Gregory was an activist in the Black Liberation Movement in the South. We're walking across the street, and he said, you know, I've never seen him. I said, you've never seen Lenny? And he said, no. I said, well, you're in for something, Greg. Lenny's in the middle of a routine, and he spots Greg, and he stops the routine. And he starts looking around with that ferret-like, weasel kind of look that he had of darting his eyes back and forth over the audience. It was making the people a little bit nervous. And then finally he broke the silence by saying, are there any niggers here tonight? Gregory stiffened like a retriever, because nobody had ever heard that word ever, ever used in a nightclub. Lenny looked around and he said, well, I think I see a nigger here was standing at the bar talking to the two guinea owners. And next to them, there's a couple of lace curtain mix. I see a couple of spicks over there, and there's a square head talking to them, and there are two grease balls over there in the corner. And I see some hunky-funky boogie and two sheenies and one jigaboo. And he went on and on and on with every derogatory racial term that he could think of. And by this time, the audience was hysterical, laughing, because it was a laughter of liberation. He finally said, bit him up, six more niggers, I passed for two dykes, four kikes, and eight niggers. When the audience finally quieted down, he said, why have I done this? Have I done this for shock value? He said, well, if all of the niggers started calling each other nigger all the time, not only among themselves, which they do anyway, but among the Ofays, among the white people, and if President Kennedy got on the radio and said, I'm seriously considering appointing two or three of the top niggers in the country into my cabinet, in 6 months, nigger wouldn't have any meaning at all. Nigger wouldn't mean any more than good night, God bless you, or I promise to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And when that beautiful day comes, you'll never find some kid come home from school crying because some Ofay motherfucker called him a nigger. Well, Dick Gregory turns to me, and he's very solemn, and Gregory says, this man is the eighth wonder of the world. He said, you have to go back to Mark Twain to find anything remotely like him. And if they don't kill him, or if they don't put him in jail, he's liable to shake up this whole fucking country.
For neither the first time nor the last, Dick Gregory was right. They tried to put Lenny in jail, though he never served time. They didn't so much kill him as sap his will to live to the point where he allowed himself to die. And he certainly shook the country up. Steve Allen hosted the Least Square Show on network TV, and he also happened to be a major jazz buff and a pretty decent pianist. He decided to take a chance on Lenny and it was an appearance on Alan's show which rendered Lenny visible to the general public for the first time. He was no longer working to his peer group from the safety of home ground. He was about to become public property.
Whether you realize it or not, there is just about no joke or sketch, particularly of a satirical sort, that will not offend somebody. You know, a cowboy or a drunk or somebody. I don't want to equate those two already. I can see the cards are coming in. Tell you how we are going to face the problem. We have decided that once a month, we will book a comedian who will offend everybody. Fair enough? All right, and then we'll get it all over with, you see? So, ladies and gentlemen, here is a very shocking comedian, the most shocking comedian of our time, a young man who is skyrocketing to fame, Lenny Bruce. Here he is.
I promise continuity, I'll behave myself. I'll do all the lines we rehearsed, you know. That's the thing, you know, I have a reputation for being sort of controversial and irreverent and also the semantic bear trap of bad taste. But you might be interested in how I became offensive.
Well, let me tell you about the Steve Allen show. I was a little bugged with the show because of continuity. I don't know, if I work for an hour here, out of the hour I'll do maybe, although I create everything myself and everything I tell you and make you laugh that I've created on the stage, of the hour I will ad-lib 4 minutes tops. Sometimes very fertile about 10 minutes, but that's a good night. Usually about 4 minutes, top, free form. But for me ever to have to come out and open with the same word every night and finish with the same word and do the same bits in each show in order, then I don't feel like a comic at all. And you got to do this on television, and it's a bug for me. They sat me down there, and they all sat there, 15 guys. Now I went into a bit they didn't let me do on the Allen show. I have a tattoo. It's really, it's not a cockamamie or anything, it doesn't rub off. Because of this tattoo, I never can be buried in a Jewish cemetery. That's the Orthodox scene. You have to go out of the world the way you came in. No marks, no changes. So I'm over at my aunt's house in Jamaica, Long Island. So she looks and she flips. She it's a real Jewish seagull, you know. Look at you then. You ruin your arm. You can't be buried in a Jewish cemetery. I said, Mima, what are you nudging me? They'll cut this off. They'll bury this in a Gentile cemetery. All right? Okay. Now, the guy says to me, you can't do that joke. Why not? He says, well, it's definitely offensive to the Jewish people. I says, and you're out of your nut, man. He says, no, that's it. And son, any time we get any satires, any ethnic groups, there's a lot of male and you can't do the joke. I said, well, screw it. I'm not going to do the show, man. That's all. So there he goes, ha, 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 ha. That's the first defense with me all the time. I allow myself, this is a rationalization, the same poetic license as Tennessee Williams or Shakespeare. If I want to, if it's, in other words, I'll never use four-letter words for shock value, for laugh, but if it fits the character, then I want to swing with it and say it. Naturally, I know I can't do this on television, but here I'm not making any scatological references. I'm just doing a true kind of bit. So now, I'm really getting hot with a guy. You're not going to do the joke, and yes, and don't tell us. Now they argue for about an hour. They keep me in the corner. I'm like the leper with a bell on my neck waiting. The guy goes back. He says, we talked it all over, Lenny. You know, it's definitely offensive to the Gentile people, too. Oh, yeah? And how do you figure that? He says, well, what you're saying in essence is that the Gentiles don't care what they bury.
It wasn't just humor. It was a classically modernist form of meta-humor in which the process became the subject. Lenny was pulling back the carpet and exposing the wiring of his comedy. The notion of bringing backstage onto the stage was intrinsic to his work. So why should he exempt himself?
I feel some guilt. The fact that my salary exceeds 20-fold. School teachers in states like Oklahoma, they get $3,200 a year. which is a disgrace, school teacher salaries. I'm not that much of a moralist. If I were, I would be donating my salary then to school teachers. You know, I admit that. If a man came to me and said, well, we're going to levy a tax and we're going to raise school teacher salaries to $750 a week, I would approve of it and pay the tax like that. Because I realize it's an insurance factor. If school teachers get that kind of money, then the education system will change immediately. I'm a hustler. As long as they give, I'll grab. But I know that someday they're going to have a tribunal. They'll line us up, the Gabi and the Black Shrouds, all the performers. All right, line them up. All the offenders there, state their names and their salaries. The sentences will be then meted out. The first offender, what is your name there? Frankie Lane. How much do you make a week, Mr. Lane? $10,000 to $12,000 a week. It's remarkable. What do you do to earn from $10,000 to $12,000 a week? Do you spend one, burn his wig. Break his legs, 30 years in jail. Get them up here, the next one. The one that's worshiping the bronze god of Frank Sinatra. What is your name? Sammy Davis Jr. And how much do you make a week, Mr. Jr.? $20,000, sometimes $30,000 a week. What do you do to earn from $20,000 to $30,000 a week? Hey, Dean, I got a booth of that old black. Take away his Jewish star and stocking cap and the religious statue of Elizabeth Taylor. 30 years in Biloxi. All right. Now.
Which brings us back to where we came in. A snowbound midnight at Carnegie Hall. It had taken Lenny a mere 4 years, from 1957 to 1961, to claw his way from the pits to the Premier League, from emceeing in strip joints to selling out America's most prestigious concert hall with a one-man show.
And I'm really getting on this plateau of thinking. There's no right and wrong. Just my right, you're wrong, and vice versa. If I'm in Cuba, you dig, and I get a lot of bread, and Castro wants a text, and he said, okay, you got a lot of bread and these poor people, and you're going to get $5,000. I said, no, man, I don't like you. Don't touch my money. He said, I want to give it. No, man, let me be Christ. I want to lay the bread on them. But don't you disperse my money, then I don't like Castro. But if I haven't got any bread, and he's a savior, then even a promise, frigate, something, man, then I love him, then he's right. And when you get to morals, it's just your morals, man. And not even morals, the mores. Because we got the Romans, right? We're all Romans and we're all correct. We've got a good government. We have, our whole judicial system is really an art form, sculpt. We're beautiful people. But this group is against everything that's good. This group are called Christians. And what do we do with the Christians? There's only one thing that is correct and moral to do them. Throw them to the lions. Now, as rough as segregation gets, boy, lion fressing, that's, yeah. I'd rather be schlepped away from a lunch counter any day. Yeah, there's a definite quantitative difference between, you know, being refused the right to service and served as refuse. You know. No, don't make it. But the Romans, we're correct and we're right and we're going to do this thing.
Where traditional mainstream comedy was tightly structured and based around jokes, Lenny Bruce improvised. At a time when all others paid lip service to America the Beautiful, he jibed at America the Corrupt. When issues of race and sexuality were taboo, he probed them until they bled.
But here's a disease where there is a cure. 2 days you can wipe it out. But yet it's a big problem. Why? Because people still say it. So the United Fund, when they came to the door, you didn't say, just a minute, I want to talk to you. How much of my buck is going to the clap, mister? Or maybe you did ask, you know. If you didn't, you were doing a disservice to the buck. Yeah, because it's a crippler, man. You got to ask. And maybe next year Jerry Lewis would have a muscular dystrophy, a clap-a-thon on television and wipe it out completely. Or maybe you're that sub-intellect that feels, I don't have to talk about that because only bums get that. Okay? Who gets that? But bums and communists and beggars and thieves. People of any spiritual aspect, they never get that. The 18 million war heroes that got knocked off with it, of course, I don't know how they got it.
Purple Heart guys, yeah, heavyweight. During the war, heavy disease. Still, every community. So it'd be great with the chicks with the bridge tables and the cans outside of Lenny's. You don't have to clap, it'd be big to see.
Lenny Bruce had appeared on the radar of the decent folk. And as decent folk always do when affronted, they commenced a terrible revenge. Time magazine, their traditional voice, castigated the so-called sick comedians. Ignoring the weight and substance of Lenny's act, they seized on a handful of his more trivial throwaway one-liners in order to single him out as the sickest of the sick. Time was acknowledging his preeminence, but also declaring him fair game. From that moment on, it was open season on Lenny Bruce.
When I interviewed Lenny, the first question I asked him was, could you be bribed to do only safe material from now on?
Paul Krasner.
And his answer, which has stayed with me, because I asked myself the same question, he said, well, what's the bribe? Eternal life? A cure for cancer? $45 million? What's the difference what I take? I'd still be selling out.
Curiously enough, Lenny wasn't busted for any radically transgressive statement concerning politics, sexuality, or race. He got in trouble for a relatively straightforward account of a conversation he'd had with his agent about a possible gig in a gay bar.
The guy says, there's a place in San Francisco, but they've changed the policy. Well, what kind of a show is it, man? Well, you know. Well, no, I don't know, man. It sounds kind of a weird show. Well, it's not a show, they're a bunch of cocksuckers, that's all. A damn fag show, and that's... Oh, well, that is a pretty bizarre show. I don't know what I could do in that kind of a show. Well, now we want you to change all that. Well, that's a big gig. I can just tell him to stop doing it.
The bust. What I got arrested for?
In San Francisco.
San Francisco, I got arrested for, what do you think? We can hear that, Daddy. I'm not going to repeat the word because I want to finish the gig here tonight. It's, they said it was vernacular for a favorite homosexual practice, a 10-letter word. It's really chic. That's 2 four-letter words and a preposition. I wish I could tell you the word. It's, starts with a C. Well, you know what the word is. Now, it's weird how they manifested that word as homosexual. Because I don't. That relates to any contemporary chick I know, or would know, or would love, or would marry, you know. And, now, when I took the bus, I finished the show, I said that word, you know, the 10-letter word, and he comes over and says, Lenny, my name is Sergeant Blah Blah. You know the word you said? I said a lot of words that time. Well, that word. Oh, yeah. Well, Lenny, that's against the law, and I'm going to take you down. Okay, that's cool. It's against the law to say it and to do it. Well, I didn't do it, man. I know, but I just have to tell you that all the time. Okay. All right. Now, get in the court to swear the heat in. What'd he say? Your Honor, he said blah, blah, blah. The judge. He said blah, blah, blah. Then the guy really yanked it up. That's right. I didn't believe it. There was a guy up on the stage in front of women and a mixed audience saying blah, blah, blah. The judge. Well, this I never heard. Blah, blah, blah. Said blah, blah, blah. He said blah, blah, blah. I'm not going to lie to you. It's in the minutes. I'm not going to lie to you. All right. The DA. The guy said blah, blah, blah. Look at him. He's smug. He's not going to repent. Then I dug something. They sort of like saying blah, blah, blah.
The San Francisco authorities were still smarting from their humiliating failure in prosecuting Allen Ginsberg's Howl for obscenity, and Lenny seemed a far softer target. Lenny was tried and convicted in the blink of an eye. Enter young attorney Al Bendick, a key player in the Howl acquittal. Pouncing on a technical error by the judge, Bendick managed to win Lenny a retrial.
Judge Axelrod heard a description of the show from a police officer, and that was enough for him. And he said, well, yeah, sure, this is terrible. This is obscene stuff. You're guilty. That's one of the reasons why, after we were able to have a new trial granted, it was very, very important to get a jury. And the reason we wanted to have a jury trial was that we wanted to have the judge think about what the standards were carefully. And if we could get a judge who had some sophistication in this area of law, then we knew that we had a very good chance. One of the things that I had asked Lenny to do was to dress in an ordinary business suit, and he showed up the first day of trial in a specially tailored Nehru outfit in the morning and prison denims in the afternoon. I decided at that point I wasn't going to say another word about any relatively unimportant items like dress.
The First Amendment entitled Lenny Bruce the same freedom to say on a stage what he had the right to say in his own living room. And as Clayton Horne said in his instructions to the jury in the obscenity trial, Lenny Bruce could not be called obscene because what he was saying did not violate the standards of the community, that it was not utterly without redeeming social importance, and that it did not deal exclusively with a morbid interest in sex and excretia. That's the language of that rather peculiarly worded law.
I felt that if the jury followed the judge's instructions, they would be bound to acquit him. And in fact, that's what happened. They reluctantly found him not guilty. They felt that legally he had not committed an offense. But I think they felt that morally he had done something which was offensive to them. He had used language in public, which ought not to be public language. And he discussed subject matter, which was very, very uncomfortable for them to consider. He was disturbing. And that's what true artists do. They disturb people.
My name is Adolf Eichmann, and the Jews came every day to what they thought was fun in the showers. The mothers were quite ingenious. They would take children and hides them in bundles of clothing. This poem was written by Thomas Merton. And it really says a lot to me. They were quiet soon because we sealed them in. Battens on the hatches, looks through the portholes, turns the gas on, and then they would drop to the floor. They were quiet. Then Rourke and we take off the clean Jewish love rings, remove the teeth and hair for strategic defense. I made soap out of them. They hung me in full view of the prison yard, and people say Adolf Eichmann was a beast. I was the soldier. No, there are soldiers and soldiers. This was a beast. But I did a conscientious effort. I watched through the portholes. I saw every Jew burned and turned into soap. Do you people think yourselves better because you burned your enemies at long distances with missiles without ever seeing what you've done to them? Hiroshima, auf Wiedersehen und good night and thank you.
By now, Lenny was routinely compared to Swift or Aristophanes. He also found himself on the front lines of a hard-fought battle to define the parameters of American public life. In that battle, he was as vulnerable for what went into his arm as he was for what came out of his mouth.
There was a kind of competitive ego among police departments. As Lenny said, if they arrest me in town A and then in town B, town C is going to say, what kind of a toilet police department do we have if they let them alone? So there was that, and there was the cheap thrill of arresting a celebrity.
Who's that? Open up the door, Mr. Bruce. Look, I'm going to check out right now. You know my scene, that I sleep a certain time. I'd never want any calls. I told you no emergency calls. Please, Mr. Bruce, open up the door for your own good. Who is that? That's the manager. Open up the door. Vroom. The door in the wall came down. Shoo. For heat. What's this and this and this and this? Didn't nuts already. Come on, you dope addict now. Now they're looking. Hey, what are you doing with all these books here? I smoke them at night. They're all dipped in secret shtick off in there. Every page. In fact, if you go, you didn't know this, when he's... Any town, you just cut the air out of the paper from the jazz club and smoke and go out of your kayak. Come on, he's putting you on now.
He sometimes did deliberately antagonize them. If he knew that there were police in the joint, he would sometimes talk about that and bait them a little bit, and therefore he must not have been totally surprised if they hauled him away. So I think there was probably always something a little bit self-destructive about him.
When I first interviewed Lenny, I asked him what the role of a comedian was, and he said, well, you have to get a laugh every 15 to 25 seconds, and he was very precise, and he was talking about his responsibility to the nightclub owner, and then as he got more and more involved with the law, and he would, since he talked about his environment now became police wagons and courtrooms, so he would talk about that. And I said, Lenny, what happened to, you know, you're not getting a laugh every 15 to 25 seconds. And he said, well, I'm changing. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, I'm not a comedian. I'm Lenny Bruce.
If you went to see Lenny just because he was the hippest comic around and because he was the funniest comic around, say, vintage 1959.
Historian Frank Kofsky.
And then you stop back in around 1961 or 1962 or 1963 or later, you might say, well, he's not funny anymore. And it's true. He isn't funny anymore in the same sense that he was, in the sense that you can just laugh without thinking or laugh without thinking very deeply and even being saddened by what... Much of what he says is very saddening.
I'm really going to get you depressed now for a minute, but I'll cook out of it. But I really want to lay it home hard here. Dear Abby, I'm a girl. I'm 14 years old, and I really come from a good religious home. And my father really gave me a good upbringing. And once there was a guy in the subway who said something dirty, my father punched him in the mouth. And I always never, it was never, and once my brother had a dirty book, and, well, he really brought us up good. And there was never any dirty words in the house, and it was really pure. And naturally, because there was no dirty words, I couldn't talk to my father too much about anything about dirty words related to. And anyway, I met this boy this summer. I fell in love, and I got in trouble. And I died this morning of blood poisoning outside of general emergency. Yeah, because your kid can't talk to you at all, man. Because they know, because of religion, how dirty that is.
Although a lot of his arrests were ostensibly for obscenity, he really was arrested for using organized religion as a target.
Christ and Moses both possessed humility. Why? Wisdom. That's it. Anybody who is secure, there's never any hostility, because he's cool. So they just stand on the back of St. Patrick's, and they listen, look around. Cardinal Spellman would be relating love and giving and forgiveness to the people, and Christ would be confused, because their route took him through Spanish Harlem. And he would wonder what 40 Puerto Ricans were doing living in one room. This guy had a ring on it, was worth $8,000. And he would wonder at the grandeur. See, why aren't the Puerto Ricans living here? It's clean and nice. What does it all mean? And what? And they'd just be shucking back and forth and talking. And maybe Bishop Sheen would see them back there and run up to Spellman on the lectern. Psst, I want to talk to you for a minute. What is it? What is it? You'll never guess who's here. Who's here? You're not going to believe me. You're going to think I've been drinking. All right, who's here? Christ and Moses. Are you putting me on now? I'm telling you they're here. Are you sure it's them? Well, I've just seen them in pictures, but I'm pretty sure it's them. Moses is a ringer for Charlton Heston, and I'm sure... Christ and Moses, both of you, they're way in the back there. Did Christ bring the family? What's his mother's name? That's weird. I read the book today, too. I'm so nervous. Mary. Mary what? I don't know. Mary Mary Hale? No. Mary Hale. Hale Mary? Harry Mary? No, I don't know what that looks like. All right, give me a direct line to Rome, quickly. Rome. All right. Hello. John Fran in New York. Listen, a couple of kids dropped in, and... you know them. One kid is, well, I'll... With a cross of bop. No, not Zorro. Dan, that's right. He brought a very attractive Jewish boy with him. They're in the back. Way in the back. Of course they're white. Yeah.
My guess is he might well still be alive and working.
Critic and columnist Nat Hentoff.
Had it not been for the fact that in New York City, the district attorney, Frank Hogan, who was revered by practically everybody. He was a very good district attorney. He was also a very devout Catholic. And he was convinced that Lenny Bruce, because of his, quote, attacks, unquote, on the Catholic Church, that he had to be punished, and punished as severely as possible.
Martin Garbus had previously defended the works of Henry Miller and D.H. Lawrence.
Now, what they did in New York was, since they felt that the words alone might not lead to a conviction, they had an inspector, Ruhe, R-U-H-E, sitting in the audience, and what the inspector testified is that Lenny made a masturbatory gesture. So they tried to move it from a pure word case to words plus gestures. Now, I have seen Lenny, and I have seen him make various kinds of gestures. I have never seen him make the kind of gesture that they said he made. My judgment was that either that was a creation of the district attorney's office, or it was a creation of Ruhe, but that it didn't occur. But ultimately, that fact turned out to be very damaging for Bruce, and the judges who convicted him at the trial level referred to it.
Lenny changed at that point.
John Magnuson filmed Lenny's last nightclub performance.
But he didn't turn into the person that's often depicted. He was certainly not a little Jewish mama's boy who became a martyr. He was very good-natured. He had a wonderful, mean-spirited, savage kind of perception of what had happened to him. And he called it a comedy of errors.
I want you to know that another thing, too, that I've never been in jail. I've never been arrested. That's all bullshit. What it is, see, I got a publicity agent that's dynamite. And we have 9 phony cops that work for Pinkerton. And we go from town to town, the same bullshit, you know. I get busted, I write the column the next day, and that's where it's at.
And he was holed up in a sleazy hotel in Greenwich Village, the Marlton. I'd go up there and talk to him, and he'd have briefs and opinions and legal texts strewed all over the place. And he really was utterly convinced that the answer to his troubles was right there. And the Supreme Court would say, Mr. Bruce, we want to apologize for all the mistakes that have been done to you in the lower courts, and you are now free.
The prosecutors who bought the case knew that once he was convicted, there'd be, let's say, a year or two till you took the appeal. And in that period of time, nobody would touch him in New York, and nobody would probably touch him throughout the country. So by getting a conviction, even if it's reversed, you have basically, and given the financial pressure that Bruce had, and the relationship between him taking drugs and the emotional pressure, that a conviction that lasted even for a year and a half would fundamentally end Bruce.
I saw him about two weeks before he died. He was wearing army fatigues, a combat jacket, and had put on quite a bit of weight. He had broken his leg, had his leg in a cast with a crutch. I think he fell out of a hotel window across the street here. I don't know what he was on, but he just didn't give a damn at that point.
On August the 3rd, 1966, Lenny Bruce died of a drug overdose at his home in Los Angeles. He was never very good with endings. If there is an endemic flaw to his classic routines, it was his chronic inability to come up with a punchline. And true to form, he screwed up his own ending by not staying around long enough to be acknowledged and forgiven. 2 years after his death, the Supreme Court did indeed, just as he had hoped, reverse his conviction and formally dismiss all outstanding charges against him.
Lenny wasn't murdered in the sense that somebody put a pistol up against his head and pulled the trigger, but for a person like Lenny, he had to work. He lived to perform. He lived to share his insights and perceptions with other people. If you deny him that opportunity, then, as I say, in effect, you've sealed his death warrant.
You know, working Carnegie Hall was, I dig it, you know. But I had a lot of fantasies with it, you know. 2 great fantasies. One, he introduces me and I come out with a violin and I just cook it. But for an hour, man, every Stravinsky heavy, and I don't say a word, finish and I split.